Hello friends, my name is Mahima Mishra and I am the teacher educator for Pedagogy of English. Today we are going to do Unit 4, Oral and Aural Approach to Language Teaching. What is the meaning of oral? Oral means anything related to the mouth. So whenever we have teaching skills like reading, elocution, debate, that is oral because we have to speak in that. What is the meaning of aural? Aural has come from the word auditory. Auditory means listening skill. So when we add oral and listening skills, then we have the aural activities. The various activities that are related to oral and aural speaking skills are audiolingualism, situational approach, comprehension-based approach, communicative approach. We will start with audiolingualism. Earlier, when we had only oral approaches, we used to have reading as a major activity. We used to have the direct approach, which disregarded the quality of listening skill. So, it gave rise to audiolingualism, which is a reaction to the reading approach. It became prominent in America in 1940, 50 and 60s. It is much like the direct approach but takes structural, linguistics and behavioral psychology into account. So therefore, we pay attention to the sentence structure, we pay attention to the linguistics, we pay attention to the learner, how the learner behaves, what is typical of the learner. So audiolingualism generally believes in making the learner listen to an audio and then react to it. Approach to audiolingualism. There are various approaches to audiolingualism. The first, the very foremost, is the dialogue style, where the teacher and the learners are in direct communication with each other. They talk to each other in the form of dialogues. The teacher may ask questions, the teacher may probe the child to speak his or her mind, and there is a free dialogue in class. It could also be among two children. It could be among the teacher and the learners. It could be among the children with each other. So a dialogue needs to be created in class, which could be regarding any topic. It could be regarding the chapters done, or it could be a general topic. But the child needs to be able to convey his thoughts, convey what he wants to convey. Then the other style is mimicry and memorization, where the child is given an example. The teacher reads out something or speaks something and expects the child to copy. Then there is memorization. Memorization means the child needs to learn up a portion and then speak it out verbatim, the way it has been written. That is also called rote learning. Rote learning is also good for various skills required later on from the children. For example, when they need to quote a poem, when they need to quote a paragraph from somewhere. Then grammatical rules are taught inductively. In audiolingualism, we don't give the children rules to learn up by heart. We don't first teach the structure. We speak to them. We let them learn through experience. So it is all inherent in the class atmosphere. Whatever grammar they are picking up is through copying, is through memorizing. So like the very way like we learn our mother tongue, we listen to people, we hear them talking, and we just pick up words and the way it has been structured. Same way we need to expose the children to the English language as well. Then the skills which are required for audiolingualism are in a sequence. We first listen. We learn to listen first and then speak later. After speaking comes reading, and then writing is the last thing. It can be postponed for a later time. So the most important skill required for audiolingualism would be listening. Listening is very important because that is the first step to speaking, to be able to effectively communicate further on. Then pronunciation is also very important because there are certain words which can be spelt in a different way, but the pronunciation is different. We can take the word read For example, at times it is pronounced as read and at times it is pronounced as read. So the way it has to be pronounced should be very, very clear with the learner. So it's the teacher's prerogative to make the learner understand when to speak read and when to say read. Same goes for many other words which have a different pronunciation, which at times don't match with the written spelling of the word. For example, the poem Lochinvar, the spelling is Lochinvar, but it is pronounced as Lochinvar and not Lochinvar. Same goes for genre. Genre is the spelling, but we don't pronounce it as genre, we pronounce it as genre. Approach to audiolingualism. The teacher needs to know how to approach this particular style of teaching. In this style, the vocabulary is severely limited. In the beginning, we don't need to expose the child to a lot of different kinds of words because after all, it's a foreign language for the child. So we need to use simple words. We need to start with very limited vocabulary. We don't need to speak too much. We need to speak less and we need to make the child understand the words that we speak. We need to make the child know exactly those few words that need to be introduced initially. Then we need to be very, very diligent in preventing learner errors. We cannot be very casual with the errors that the children make. For example, if they make a mistake in structuring the sentence, we need to tell them there and then, because while speaking, they are learning. They are not writing anything at the moment, so they need to know where they made mistakes and what should they do to rectify those mistakes. Language is manipulated without regard to meaning or context. That means that whatever language they are speaking, that is important. We don't need to confirm whether it is according to the context that has been taken or whether the meaning is true or not. Meaning could be untrue, but what we are focusing on is that the language needs to be correct. It needs to be correctly structured. Then the teacher should be proficient in structure and vocabulary. If the teacher is using the audiolingualism tool, they need to know that they cannot afford to make a mistake. They need to be very proficient in structure and vocabulary, and if the teacher is not a native speaker, we also suggest using video and audio tapes, which are strictly made according to the norms and regulations. So there are less chances of making mistakes. Then we have a situational approach, which is also very useful because it teaches the children to react to situations. When we have a situation, what do? We move to our mother tongue. We generally fall back to the comfort zone of our mother tongue. We need to work on that. So to teach a foreign language, we need to give the children a situation and we need to tell them to remain in the target language. We cannot allow them to speak their mother tongue or to try to resort to different other ways. We have to stick to the foreign language or to the English language in this case. This situational approach was created or came into existence because of the reading approach. In the reading approach, generally we only read out. At times, reading out was so important that even though the child doesn't understand what he's reading, if he reads out fluently, he is considered to be well spoken in the language, which is obviously a not so good approach, because we need to know that the child is comfortable in the language. Only reading a language is not enough. So this became very dominant during the 1940s, 50s and 60s in Britain. It was a result of the negative factors of the reading approach. Much like the direct approach, the situational approach adds features from linguistics and language pedagogy. So the new methodologists realized that the the grammar and the language pedagogy, means the way the English language is taught, is all based on behavioral factors. So that also needs to be included. So when you have a situational approach, the child imagines himself or keeps himself in a particular situation and then reacts according to that in the English language. Using situational approach, we have to remember that the spoken language is primary. The child may not be grammatically correct all the time, or the sentence structure may not always be, you know, perfect, but the child should be able to speak in the language that is being taught, that is English in this case. Oral learning more important than writing. We have to be very, very clear that writing has to be postponed. Writing cannot be the major factor to assess the child's learning in a situational approach. He or she must be able to communicate orally, fluently, clearly and proficiently. Only the target language to be used in the classroom, that is a very important fact, that we need to use the English language. We cannot be using any other language to express ourselves. We need to use English language in this case. The most general and useful terms to be used and presented. We do not want to fluster the child. We do not want to make the child scared, or we do not want to suddenly prove something to the child. We need to make the child comfortable in that language. So we need to use very, very general terms in the beginning. We want the child to understand the language. We want the child to know how to use that language. And therefore, we start from simple and move on to complex. Using situational approach, there are various situations in class where the situational approach can be used. The only thing that we have to remember is that we have to move from simple to complex in grammatical structure. New items are introduced and practiced situationally. For example, if the child knows how to present himself in a class, he is supposed to be given more practice with examples like, how does it feel to be at the post office? How will you communicate at a post office? How will you communicate in English at a bank? How will you communicate at the dinner table? And so on. The child could also be given examples like a telephonic conversation. So situations need to be created to teach this particular tool to the child. The other tool is the comprehension-based approach. The comprehension-based approach is an outgrowth of research in first language acquisition. What happened was, the behaviorists, the linguists, they thought that the way we learn our mother tongue is the best way to learn any language. So they did a lot of research in the theory of language acquisition, first language acquisition, that is our mother tongue. How do we learn the first language? When a child is born, he hears and listens and reacts to his mother tongue. People around him or her are only talking in the mother tongue. And it doesn't take much time for him to pick up that language, and he starts talking in that language. So this research led to the comprehension-based approach, which means that the child needs to comprehend what he is reading or what he is listening, what he is writing, everything. Language methodologists believed that second or foreign language is very similar to foreign language acquisition. So a foreign language can also be acquired in the same way, the way a first language is acquired. Exposure to a lot of the foreign language will lead the child to start comprehending the foreign language. To use the comprehension-based approach, listening comprehension is the most important tool. Listening to comprehension, the teacher must be very fluent in reading out that comprehension passage that has been chosen as a tool for the comprehension-based approach. If the teacher is a native speaker, or if the teacher is not very confident, the teacher can use audio tapes or videotapes to be able to cater to the listening comprehension as a tool. Initially, learners only respond meaningfully in non-verbal ways. When the child starts listening to a comprehension, he must not be forced suddenly to start expressing his or her views on that particular thing, because this can come later. We must wait for the time when the child becomes confident in the language and then starts responding in that language. So initially, learners only respond meaningfully in non-verbal ways, and later they can use the language that we are teaching them. So we don't need to push them, we don't need to force them to speak in the target language immediately. Don't force the learner to speak or respond. When the learner responds willingly, the pronunciation and understanding are better than when we are forcing them to do it. Using comprehension-based approach. Whenever we are choosing a comprehension passage for the child or for the class, we need to think one level beyond their competence. If the passage is too easy, then the child will not listen so attentively, or there will be no learning happening. We need to choose something one step beyond their level of competence. No error correction required. When a child is responding to a listening comprehension, we don't need to correct him, because multiple opinions, multiple reactions are accepted. It's a comprehension. So each child, each learner has a right to comprehend whatever has been read out or whatever has been given to them in their own unique way. Proper selection of audio tapes and videotapes is very important, because it could lead to a lot of misunderstanding in case the teacher is not very fluent or clear in their spoken English. Next comes the communicative approach. This grew out of the work of anthropological linguists like Himes in 1972 and Ferdian linguists like Halliday in 1973, who view language first and foremost as a system of communication. The most important function of any language is to communicate, is to convey a message from the sender to the receiver. That is the most important function of any language, and that is what the communicative approach believes strictly in. The main goal is to communicate in the target language. So when we use the communicative approach, we need to communicate with our learners in the target language. If we are teaching them English, we need to talk in English all the time. Less importance is given to linguistic structures, and more importance is given to concepts and facts and social functions. What is a social function? A social function is the service or the use of that language. What is the use of a language? It is to communicate. So that is the most important thing. And also, to communicate concepts is important. Whether the child is speaking 100% accurate grammar or he is making a few errors is not that important. Then we have activities in groups and pairs in communicative approach, because we need more than one person who is sending the messages, and we need another one to receive the messages. So we need more people. It cannot be a one-sided activity. Various tools of communicative approach are role plays, dramatization, and these two tools are very, very effective in communicative approach. When the child gets an opportunity to play out a part or to dramatize a part, then that child gains a lot of confidence in that language. And then the child knows how to communicate that feeling in that language. The teacher's role is primarily to facilitate learning. The teacher does not need to do much. The children need to communicate. So when we are using the communicative approach, the children are using that tool to communicate with each other or to communicate their feelings or thoughts or points to the teacher. The teacher should be fluent and confident in the target language, because the teacher is a model in front of the learners in this case. If the teacher is confident, if the teacher can communicate well in the language, then definitely the children will also pick it up. So the major tools of teaching oral English are reading, elocution, rhymes or poetry recitation, debate, drama, extempore or jam sessions. So these activities help the child to work on his oral approach. That is, how to deliver speeches from his mouth. The major tools of Aural Approach, that is how to use his listening skills, comes through listening comprehensions. Listening comprehensions, when the child gets to listen to an audio or a videotape, or he gets to listen to his teacher and he answers the questions through either MCQs or he answers orally. That is called an audio approach. I hope the oral and aural approach to language learning was clear, and I wish that you perform well in front of your learners. Thank you so much. Hope to meet you again.